This video gives you a bird's eye view of what Next.js is and how it works. This frontend framework has been a hype in the web development world, especially in the recent years, which is evident from this Google Trends graph. To learn Next, you need to know React.js, which is a frontend JavaScript library for creating interactive user interfaces. Because Next is built on top of React, or in other words, it helps building production-ready React applications. The framework was initially released in 2016 and it is maintained by Vercel, a cloud platform company. In its essence, Next allows you to run React on the server. The server will be powered by Node.js, which allows running JavaScript on the server, including React. But wait, React is a frontend JavaScript library, right? So what's the point of running it on the server? That's where the idea of client-side rendering and server-side rendering comes in. In the case of normal React application, React generates the HTML on the client, that is the user's browser. So Node.js is not required to run a normal React app. Whereas Next runs React on a Node.js server and generates HTML there. For instance, suppose you have a blog made using React. The server will only send the necessary JavaScript files along with the basic HTML markup. That means the HTML may not contain the post content, instead just a wrapper element. Now it's the browser's job to run the JavaScript code, including sending additional requests to the server and fetching the post data. Then filling the HTML layout with the received post data by rendering the React components. Finally, the user can view the blog page and interact with it. Users might feel that your pages are laggy. Also, it's not a good approach from an SEO perspective. Because initially the page doesn't contain any data, search engine spiders may not wait for it to get fully rendered. That's the problem Next tries to solve by taking React to the server. Pages are fully generated on the server before being sent to the client. So browsers and search engines receive the content without the need to make extra requests. And users experience faster page loads. And it's better for SEO. In addition to that, Next also sends some client-side JavaScript code, which helps make the app interactive. That's the reason why a Next app behaves like a single page application, page transitions without reloading the browser. In short, the best of both worlds, fast page loads of a static HTML site plus the interactive interface of a React application. But then, why not just use a static site generator like Hugo or Gatsby? They also render pages on the server, right? But Next.js is not just a static site generator. It supports three modes of pre-rendering HTML pages. Static site generation is only one of them. The highlight here is server-side rendering, the other being incremental static regeneration. Server-side rendering is useful for highly dynamic web pages. For instance, think of the homepage of a buzzing e-commerce store. With server-side rendering, a page is rendered on the server only when a request comes in for that page. Here is how it works. Suppose a user requested the store page. Upon receiving the request, Node server runs React, fetches the data from the backend API, and generates the page. Then sends it back to the client. Browser displays the page, which contains the latest data. Whereas static site generation generates all the pages in advance during build time. That is when you run the npm run build command. So when a user requests the blog page, it's already there on the server. Server only needs to send it. Overall, it is faster than server-side rendering and puts less demand on the backend API. Because backend API is only required during build time. So static generation is considered better for blog-like sites where the content doesn't change much. Incremental static regeneration stands somewhere in between. it can be used to generate individual pages without the need to build the entire site every time you add or modify a page on your site. It starts with static site generation, that is, you run the npm run build command, which generates the initial set of pages. On top of that, Next allows re-rendering any page with fresh data at set intervals. Just set the revalidate property and the time interval in your code. For instance, if you set the revalidate property of the home page to 60 seconds, Next will refetch the data from the backend and regenerate the page when a new request comes in after that time period. The revalidate property can be set on a per page basis. If you are still confused, let's see how the tech stack looks like for a typical Next.js site. On one side, we have the frontend server running Next app on a Node.js environment. By default, Next uses the port 3000. But it's usually a common practice to put an Nginx reverse proxy in front of it. On the other side, we have the backend API server, which is exposed using Nginx or Apache. The backend app can be anything like headless WordPress, Express.js, Laravel, etc., along with the database where the data is actually stored. The two servers can communicate each other over the network. This allows the frontend React app to fetch data from the backend API, usually in JSON format. The backend app usually includes an admin panel. Site editors or admins can log in there to manage the content stored inside the database. With proper setup, the backend server may notify the Next server when content changes. Next app can fetch content whenever it wants to render new pages or update existing ones. This is then served to the users from the site's domain name. In a Next.js project, all the pages and routes are stored inside the pages directory. For instance, if you define a file called contact.js inside the pages directory, Next will automatically render it as a page on your site. And each page or route is actually a React component, which returns the output, that means the HTML markup and the content in JSX format. If you are familiar with React, then it will be a no-brainer. In addition to static routes, you can also define dynamic routes. For instance, here is the file corresponding to a blog post page. Here the file name is slug.js within square brackets, which tells that it's a dynamic route. And the value of the slug will be taken from the URL path. Within the pages directory, you can find another directory called API. It's for you to put server-only routes. Next will not render them as pages on your site. An example use case is when you want to manage form submissions from contact forms. Within the project root, there is another directory called public where you can put images, phones, and other such assets required for the site. The Node server serves any files from this directory on the site's frontend. For instance, if you have a file called public home.jpg, it will be accessible from the URL domain/home.jpg. Also, the site's CSS files are usually put within the styles directory. Both global CSS as well as module CSS can be put here. This file main.css includes the CSS rules applicable to the whole site. It can be imported to the app.js file located in the project root to make it available to all the pages. In the case of CSS modules like home.module.css, you can import them to individual pages. Import the file as home styles from path styles/home.module.css. Then you can use the class names like normal JavaScript objects. Suppose I want to create a div with the class name grid. Div class name equals homestyles.grid, and grid is a class name defined inside the CSS file. Another one is the .next directory, which is by default a hidden directory. When you finally run the build command, the statically generated files get stored inside this directory. This is from where the Node server serves your application. The directory is added to the gitignore file to prevent it from being pushed to the remote repository. Now let's discuss data fetching in Next.js. Usually data is stored in a separate location from the frontend and made available via a JSON API. For instance, in the case of this block, we want to fetch the post list from a remote WordPress API. Here is the file responsible for rendering the blog index page. In order to do that, we want to provide the React component with an array of post items fetched from the remote API. For statically generated pages, such tasks like fetching data is done within the getStaticProps function. On the other hand, for server-side rendered pages, we could use the getServerSideProps function instead. For us, the programmers, both the functions behave the same way. The getStaticProps function is executed on the server only. It will not be shipped to the client side, so you can safely make API requests that require authentication. Also, any data returned by the getStaticProps or the getServerSideProps functions will be available to the component function as props. In this case, the function blog_home. Another function I want to mention is the getStaticPaths function, which is used with dynamic routes. For instance, consider the route slug.js, which is a route that represents a single blog post. And here is the component responsible for rendering the post page, function post. Our blog may contain hundreds or thousands of posts, right? So Next needs to generate all of them statically using this slug.js route during build time. For that to happen, we want to supply the route with a list of post slugs fetched from the remote API. That's what the getStaticPaths function does. It fetches the slug list and returns it. Next goes through them during build time to generate the individual pages in association with the getStaticProps function. Apart from running React on the server and generating pages, Next also ships some JavaScript to the client side to make the pages interactive. That's where a feature called tree shaking comes into the picture. It's the process of removing unused code from the bundle. This allows you to use server-only JavaScript modules like the file system module. For instance, here we are using the fs module to fetch post data from the file system. But the fs module is used only within the getStaticProps function, which, as I said before, is a server-only function. You can see it here. So the fs module will not be included in the client-side JavaScript bundle. That's what tree shaking is, removal of unused code. Another feature worth mentioning is code splitting. If we take a look at the client-side code using the inspect element tool, inside the head tag we can see some JavaScript files. These are small chunks of JavaScript code applicable for the current page we are viewing, which means Next has split the code into small pieces for each page so that it will not affect performance. Now let's take a look at some of the other important features Next offers. The first one is the built-in head component, which can be imported using import head from next/head. This allows you to set the things within the head tag, such as title, meta description, etc. for each page, and it gets rendered on the front end like this. So you don't need to figure out a way to set up SEO tags. Other two component related features I want to mention are the built-in link and image components. The built-in link component enables navigating between pages without refreshing the browser tab. For instance, here the menu items are displayed using the link component. So pages load as if in a single page application. Also, Next can prefetch the link URLs, so users get a faster experience when they are browsing the site. Speaking of the image component, here the logo image is displayed using the built-in image component. It offers several advantages over a simple HTML img tag, like lazy loading, responsive images, and things like that. If we inspect the frontend code, you can see that Next has converted the image component to an equivalent img tag with all these features attached. By the way, now we are viewing the site in production mode, started using the npm run start command. Apart from that, Next also comes with the development mode. It's used while you are developing the application, so no need to build the site every time to view the changes. The dev server can be started using the command npm run dev. Like production, dev server is also started on port 3000. The development server will be slightly slower than the production mode because it fetches data and render pages in real time. The fast refresh feature allows you to view the changes in real time as you edit the application files. Now I am on the blog index page, and let me place the editor and the browser windows side by side. Here we can see that the page has a white background. Suppose I want to change the background to something else, for instance, blue. So let me add the class bgblue200, and we can see the change instantly without refreshing the page. That's cool, right? Next also comes with helpful error messages. Suppose I make an error somewhere here. Okay, and the page displays what the error is. Here it says variable is undefined. Correct the error, save the file, and the error goes away. That's how the fast refresh feature works. You won't lose any state data either during the refresh. Apart from these, Next offers a lot more features, but I think it's enough for this intro video. See you in the next one.